Welcome. I'm Chandan Gowda. I'm faculty at Azim Premji University. Christophe Jaffrelot will deliver the Azim Premji University public lecture this evening. He is research director at CNRS Sciences Po. He's also visiting faculty at King's Institute, London and Princeton. He is, as most of you would already be aware, he's a distinguished scholar of South Asia, which in this case includes India and Pakistan. Typically, South Asia comes to mean India. His contributions have been major in the fields of the formation of Hindu nationalism in the country, the rise of the lower caste in North Indian politics, and he's edited very many influential volumes, The Lives of Muslims in Indian Cities, Middle Class Consumption in India and China, and a book on Pakistan, A Nation Without Nationalism, and a book on Pakistan is to be published next year called The Paradox of Pakistan, Resilient and Contradictions and Resilience. And he just mentioned that a study of Modi is complete and which will be out next month. His lecture this evening is titled Facets of Islamic Politics in Pakistan. I invite Dr. Jaffrelot to...
Dear Chandan, for organizing this very effectively as usual. I'm not that tall. He's very tall, you know. How much time do we have? 45 minutes. So I'll try to cover this ground that is very, very broad, facets of Islamic politics in Pakistan. And to begin with, I would like to say what are the movements, facets of this kaleidoscope that I'm not covering. I'm dealing with the Islamists, which means that I'm not dealing with the Muslim League, of course, but what goes without saying goes even better with saying it, by saying it. Of course, the Muslim League used Islam to define a community which needed to be protected from the Hindu majority if we look at Jinnah's discourse. But as you know, Jinnah was secular. He was not for any kind of theocracy. He was not even a practicing Muslim either. So we will exclude the Muslim League, even though by the end of my talk, I'll return to today's Muslim League, Nawaz Sharif's Muslim League, which has some affinities with some of the Islamists. And I will not talk either of the Jamaat-e-Islami and of the Jamaat-ulema-Islam, which are fundamentalist parties. And if I exclude them, it's because they play the game of electoral politics. And the movements I want to cover, and it's already very rich, are of a different kind. First, those who indulge in sectarianism, the Shia-Sunni conflict, which is a very important development everywhere in the Muslim world, but particularly in Pakistan. Then the jihadi groups, which are of a special quality, those who do jihad cum dawah. And I'll focus on the Lashkar-e-Taiba in that respect. And last but not least, the movement I will try to dwell on, because it is less well known and probably more influential, the Pakistani Taliban, the TTP, which are of a different category. Even though, and that will be my conclusion, these three trends have to be looked at separately, but they do converge and they do interact, and they may even have merged in some respect, at least in some places. Well, let's begin with the sectarian movement. Well, again, something that is well known, but you need some time to repeat things which are well known. For decades, probably for centuries, Shias and Sunnis of South Asia have been very close. Even if you return to the Mughal Empire, even if you return to Aurangzeb, Aurangzeb himself, in spite of all his religious dogmatism, had something like one third of his aristocracy, of his senior functionaries, who were Shias. And the Sunnis, who represent popular Islam the better way, the Barelwis, have never been anti-Shia. Even many of them have taken part in the Muharram ceremonies, even though they did not practice flagellation, but they were there. And that is not true anymore, but it was true for decades. And of course, last but not least, the most important Sufi order, probably in Saudi Arabia, the Shistis, did not discriminate against Shias. So we have a long tradition of no distinction, no differentiation between Shias and Sunnis. Of course, things started to become more complicated during the British Raj. And it's not only because of the foreign end, so to speak, but it's because of competition for power. And that was what we saw in Lucknow, in the Awadh state, where we have a competition between the former Shia ruling dynasty and the emerging rising Sunni bourgeoisie that resulted in Shia-Sunni riots for the first time in 1906. Yet, when Pakistan was created, this distinction was not there at any rate. And when you look at the functionaries, I mean, even not the leaders, Jinnah, to begin with, who is a Khoja, who was an Ismaili, he was not at all a Sunni at all. And he was not the only one. People who are less well known, Iskandar Mirza, who was the first governor general who seized power and sealed the fate of democracy in 56, a Shia. Yahya Khan, who took over from Ayub Khan in 69, a Shia. And the Bhuttos, we don't know really. And we will never know. But what we know for sure is that Zulfikar Ali Bhutto was married to an Iranian woman. And we also very well know that the way the martyrdom of Benazir is celebrated in Sindh has many Shia of a tone. And the kind of martyrology that developed there has a lot of Shia of a tone. So when did it start? Well, it started in the 70s. It started for two, I would say, complementary reasons, one external, one internal. The Iranian Revolution definitely made an impact, even more when Ayatollah Khomeini started to target Pakistan as the first place where he would export the Islamic Revolution. So the Iranians started to replace the old zakirs, the clerics, by new ones trained in Iran, and they contributed to change the mind of the Shia community, making them much more assertive, much more even demanding so far as their share of power in Pakistan was concerned. But this external factor interacted with a domestic factor that was even more important. And that was Zia's Islamization policy. That was, in fact, a Sunnization policy, as the reform of the zakat suggested. You know, the way he wanted to reform the zakat was so Sunni-oriented that Shias had no opportunity, but no other choice, but to mobilize and force him to retreat, but a bit too late. By 79, a movement for the implementation of Shia jurisprudence, the Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan, had taken shape and Shias had a political voice. In reaction, the Sunnis started the Sipahi Sahaba, SSP. That was, of course, something the Saudis funded to a great extent. So you saw this new battleground, Pakistan, as a proxy war, as a place for the proxy war between Iran and Saudi Arabia for the leadership of the Muslim world. Well, this SSP movement had one point agenda, to exclude the Shia community from the perimeter of Islam, the same way they had done with the Ahmadiyyas. As you may know, Ahmadiyyas were declared non-Muslim in 74 by Bhutto himself and under the pressure of the Jamaat Islami, of Maududi, but also of many people who joined the SSP later on. But Shias and Ahmadiyyas were not the same for one simple reason. Shias represent 20% of the Pakistani population, when the Ahmadiyyas are a minuscule minority of 0.1 or 2%. So the conflict between Sunnis and Shias took a violent turn, first of all, in the 80s, late 80s, early 90s, you saw a lot of targeted killings. I will not mention them all, of course, but one or two need to be referred to. 1990, Ak Nawaz Jangvi, the founder of the SSP, was shot dead, probably by a Sunni rival, but the SSP attributed this killing to a Shia, and in retaliation, they killed the Iranian consul of Lahore. And that was one of the many target killings that took place. This is the time when the SSP radicals started the Lashkar-e-Jangvi. The Lashkar-e-Jangvi in 1994 was started, named after the founder of the SSP, and became a radical movement made of killers, really, who started to kill not only leaders, but also middle-class Shias. This is the time, the 90s, when you saw so many doctors, there are many Shia doctors in Pakistan, even army officers killed selectively. That was the second stage after targeted killings. The third stage is the stage we are still in, and that is mass killings. Bombs explode outside a mosque after the Friday prayer. Suicide bombers decimate a procession or a family celebration, and each time they kill dozens of people. When you look at the figures, and I have a table there that I can summarize easily, we have now every year something like 500 casualties, which is, by the way, the number of people who die because of Maoism in India, because of Maoism and counter-Maoism, which is not a small number, especially in a country which is much smaller, that is Pakistan. And what is important to note is that we have now few incidents, but many casualties. In 2010, we have 57 attacks, killing 509 people, which shows that they are much more devastating than they used to. In 89, we had 67 incidents, killing only 18 people. So the scale has completely changed. Now you have less attacks, but much more devastating. That's a new modus operandi. I would say, in addition to that, that sectarianism has become part of everyday life in Pakistan. There was a time not so far away when you have Shias and Sunnis who get married, and you never asked, you did not know, and you didn't want to know. It's just now something you can't think about that easily. And of course, it's completely politically incorrect to mention this publicly, because in the end, this is the land for the Muslims. So you can't discriminate, you should not publicly discriminate. But privately, you will now see, for instance, Sunnis who do not want to have a Shia teacher for their children. And for one simple reason, there should be only one style of namaz. And when you ask one more question, the response is, well, Sunnis are in a majority. So this is the majoritarianism of Pakistan, which is another version of the one we have here. Well, it's a discourse of power also, and sectarianism is especially strong in places where you have socio-economic conflicts between Shia landlords and Sunni bourgeois asking for more. This is typical of Jhang district. And it is typical of Punjab at large. So that's one. That's one facet. And I will end this first point on that, which has resulted in different strategies for the minorities. Minorities always try to save their skin in one way or another. The Shias have realized that they had no salvation path in building a party. They are too small. They cannot resort to violence. They will be crushed. So what do? First of all, they join the mainstream parties, which are the most protective. PPP was one. Secondly, they took refuge in religiosity, and religiosity in among the Shias of Pakistan has increased, and they claim now that their Shiism is even better than the Iranian Shiism. And third, which is quite interesting but quite disturbing, it's a new version of ghettoization. They try to regroup. They try to regroup in many different ways. The worst way I've heard of recently, and I'll have to check that during my next visit, is that they migrate to Karachi. Because MQM cannot afford to be sectarian. The moment the Mawajis divide themselves along these lines, they are done. So Karachi can be a place where they could take shelter. But that's not, of course, the best place to live. So that's the first facet. The second facet is, of course, jihad. And I'll try to do justice to this massive movement that jihadism has become in Pakistan. At the same time, we can't avoid going back to history to understand the roots of this jihadi politics. And I insist on the word politics, because everything started really when Zulfikar Ali Bhutto himself supported Afghan jihadists, and the names are familiar because you have certainly heard of Gulbuddin Ekmatyar, Burhanuddin Rabbani, Ahmed Shah Massoud, at least these three. These three people were there in 73, 74, fighting Pashtun nationalism, was at the helm of Afghanistan with the support of the Bhuttos. And I say the Bhuttos because Benazir will continue the same policy with the same man. General Babar was there when Zulfikar Ali Bhutto started to support these jihadists, and he was still there when Benazir started to support the Taliban and the Islamists at large. So the idea was to diminish the impact of Pashtun nationalism, to undermine Pashtun nationalism, that was something the Pakistanis have always feared, by promoting Islamists against, at that time, Daoud, who was at the helm in Kabul. But of course, this policy was upgraded after the Soviet invasion. And we need to return to this invasion because we have missed the impact it has made on the region, at least on that part of South Asia. The Afghan Mujahideen who mobilized against the Soviet invasion did it from Pakistan among refugee camps. In 88, you had 3.2 million Afghan refugees in Pakistan. 3.2 million people living in this Pashtun belt, mostly. And the ISI, with the support of the CIA, with the money of the CIA, with the money of Saudi Arabia, armed these Mujahideens. And Amit Gul, the ISI chief at that time, channeled the money, but also the foreigners. Between 82 and 92, 35,000 Muslim radicals from 43 Islamic countries came to that part of South Asia. These are the figures Ahmed Rashid gave. And they were supported by the ISI to fight the Soviets from Pakistan. Among these people, of course, were Abdullah Azam and his student, Osama bin Laden, who settled down next to Peshawar before crossing over and founding in 89 Al-Qaeda. After 10 years of war, they won, and they could take over power in Afghanistan. Those who were taking over power in Afghanistan, the Taliban, were supported again. And as I mentioned before, Benazir Bhutto's policy was to get this strategic depth, quote unquote, in Afghanistan. What needs to be highlighted here is that those who were the followers of Mullah Omar were mostly students of madrasas, dini madaris, who had been started and developed in the Pashtun belt, including the Haqqani madrasa of Akwara Katak, which is one of the most important madrasas. A number of the students who were there became members of the Taliban government. And the man who was at the helm, Samir Ulhaq, is still very much active these days. He is supposed to be the one who is being the intermediary with the Pakistani Taliban for some negotiation. This background needs to be kept in mind when we try to understand how the jihadi movement spread. Because after this victory in Afghanistan, jihadi groups were in a position to turn their guns to India and to infiltrate Kashmir. Well, one of the movements which did that, trend in Afghanistan, active in Kashmir, was of course the Arakat Nebula, Arakat ul Mujahideen, Arakat ul Ansar, and you may remember that Masood Azhar, who was one of the most active Arakat leaders, had been captured in 1994 by the Indian Army in Kashmir. And after this hijacking of the flight between Nepal and Varanasi, was freed and returned to Pakistan as a free man and started Jaish-e-Mohammed. So we saw very clearly this full circuit, trained in Afghanistan, active in Kashmir, freed in Kandahar, but back to Pakistan and well established there. But Jaish-e-Mohammed is not the most interesting movement because it's jihadist only, so to speak. Lashkar-e-Taiba is not only jihadist, I mean, it's not only dedicated to jihad, it's also dedicated to dawah. And I'd like to insist on this and highlight the characteristics, the specificity of this combination. The story is the same in the sense that it was born also in Afghanistan, in the same province almost, in Kinor, where bin Laden was based. There are affinities between the kind of Wahhabism bin Laden epitomized and the identity of LET, because the LET is Al-Hadith. So it is, in a way, the Wahhabi version of Islam that Pakistan has cultivated. These connections between Al-Qaeda and the LET was clear when we realized that bin Laden addressed the annual LET conventions by telephone three times, 95, 96, 97. And of course, when we saw the program of the agenda of the LET. Well, the man who has designed this agenda is Mohammed Sahid, who has started the Markaz al-Dawa wal-Irshad, MDI, in the mid-80s from Afghanistan before coming back to Punjab, where he's based in a kind of private city, Muridke, next to Lahore, with I repeat, but I know I will describe a two-way, a kind of dual policy. On the one hand, and that's the most well-known dimension of LET, they want to free the Indian Muslims, and they want to, in that sense, infiltrate and attack and bleed India by fedaying missions, the most famous one being first in December 2000 when they attacked the Red Fort in Delhi, and then, of course, the November 2008 Mumbai attack. But that's only one dimension. The other, the Dawah dimension, is something you can define as social work. Dawah, of course, means Islamization through preaching and example. It's a kind of role model that you propose to the Muslims for them to improve. Character building, can we say also. So they do social work and they do education. Something like 127 schools are run by the LET. They have thousands of pupils. Interestingly, they claim that they emulate the Christian education system. They say, we are setting up Islamic institutions along the lines of Christian missionary schools. That's a very interesting, phrase, sentence that Zafar Iqbal, the head of the education department of LET, wrote. It's not for them only that the Christians are a model. In many ways, they were also emulated by others. Education is there, plus social work, especially rescue work. You know, the earthquake in Kashmir in 2005 could show them coming for help to the casualties first, even before the army people. The flood, the 2010 floods, they were there, very active. And that gave them an opportunity to show to the people that they were there for them. So this movement is not only political, it's also social, it's a kind of counter-society. It's a kind of deeply rooted alternative society. And Said said that his agenda is a long-term agenda. You know, this kind of millenarist approach, I know it from here. When he says, we do not believe in revolutionary change in Pakistan, rather we want a gradual reform through Dawah. So it may take 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, one century. That's a different game, and it's different from fedayeen attacks. Third, the Pakistani Taliban. That's a different group. And that's a group that was developed in one particular place, that is the Fatah, the federally administered tribal areas. A place that represents 3% of the Pakistani population, only 1.5% of the Pakistani GDP, with a very low literacy rate. You know, the census is not that great in Pakistan, and more importantly, it is very old. You know, they could not have a census after 98 because there is so much dispute about the figures that they prefer not to have census. But still, the figures give you an idea of the problem. 17% is the literacy rate when it used to be 44% as an average in India, in Pakistan. So we have their tribal areas. The most well-known ones are South Waziristan, North Waziristan, Kuram, Khyber, which is, of course, the Khyber Pass also. These agencies, these areas, as you know, were a kind of buffer state between Afghanistan and the British Raj that the British never controlled fully, never tried even to control. They let that part of the Raj in the hands of Maliks and Khans, tribal chiefs. and they just demarcated what is known as the Durand Line. The Durand Line was a problematic border right from the beginning in 1893 and still is, because the Afghans have never recognized it as an international border. This part of the country was the place where, during the first jihad, the anti-Soviet jihad, hundreds of refugee camps were started. And when I mentioned the 3+ million refugees, they were mostly there. And they had a very disruptive impact on the local society. Not only they were there for camps, these Afghan mujahideen, but they were also there for developing dini madaris, madrasas, if you want. A new kind of network of madrasas took shape. When the second Afghan war took place in 2001, after 9/11, this is the place where Al-Qaeda and the Pakistani supporters of Al-Qaeda and the Taliban withdrew. We have estimates saying that during the fall of 2000, something like 2,000 Arabs came from Afghanistan to the Fatah, including Uzbeks. You know, this idea that, you know, the idea of Arabs is a very, very loose, I would say, category. So they would look at Arabs, they would designate as Arabs people who come from, well, many different places, but not South Asia. 2,000 Al-Qaeda fighters came mostly to North Waziristan and South Waziristan, where they were supported by local Islamists who had gone to Afghanistan before. By and large, something like 40,000 militants were concentrated in the Fatah and started to experience new devices and new techniques. One of the techniques that was imported from Iraq, because very soon afterwards the war was shifted to Iraq, was suicide bombers, suicide attacks. That was not there before. That was not at all a technique that they were using before. Now, the Fedayeen attacks, by the way, the Fedayeen attacks of the LET is not made by suicide bombers. A Fedayeen is not killing himself. He's exposing himself and wants to show his courage by attacking others, knowing fully well that he will die in the end. But it's a different game compared to the suicide bombers. These people remain rather isolated in the Fatah till the Red Mosque episode, that is a turning point. 2007 is the moment when Musharraf, under the pressure of the US, started to become really tough with the Islamists, who had been his partners before, and we know that in Kargil, for instance. And he went mostly against a place, the Red Mosque, in Islamabad. That was a mosque where, historically, right from the first jihad, Islamists had recruited a lot of their militants, activists. Now, this Red Mosque episode calls to mind the Blue Star operation in many ways. You know, they took this place by storm, killing probably more than 100 people, including women, including children. And that was the time when the Pakistani Taliban, I mean, they were not known under that name yet. The groups who were there in the Fatah, in reaction to this operation, decided to start the TTP, the Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan. And then they decided to attack the Pakistani army head-on. That was a turning point in that sense, with Betullah Mesood ambushing 250 Pakistani soldiers in a very humiliating operation immediately after the Red Mosque episode. What is important in the case of this TTP is that, again, it's not only a political organization, it's also a social organization. These people, these young clerics, they are very young. They are in their 30s, they are in their 20s. They attack the Pashtun Maliks and Khan, the old elder men. They have killed hundreds of them, and they have done that on behalf of social change, of equality, of justice, insaf. Insaf is the keyword. So they have their own courts, and people can turn to them for having their cases fixed without any delay and any corruption. So you have this moment that is a very important moment when they could get rid of the old elite, aristocratic elite, and become popular in a way among the people. And from there, they started to retaliate. And we are still in this episode. We are still in this moment. When you look at the figures of what the Pakistan Institute for Peace Studies called terrorist attacks, the number of terrorist attacks has not gone down below 2,000 a year between 2008 and last year. 2,148, 2,586, 2,113 terrorist attacks, which means either, well, the list is long, suicide attack, rocket attack, beheadings, remote control bombs, kidnappings, landmines, shootings, sabotage, fire. That's what they do. And they have not killed less than 2,000 people a year in this region mostly. When you look at the geography of this, the Fatah is the first place that is exposed. The KP, the Khyber-Pakhtunkhwa, that's the new name for the Northwest Frontier Province, comes second. And then, of course, you have Karachi, because Karachi has become the place where the Taliban are also taking over. You have now a huge Pashtun population in Karachi. Karachi is the number one Pashtun city, well, in the world. Dubai maybe number two. And then, of course, comes Peshawar. These are the places where they have become very active. What has been also, I would say, one of their achievements was, you might have heard of it, the SWAT operation in 2009. SWAT is not, it's not in the Fatah, it's just in the Malakand agency north of the Fatah. And it's closer to Islamabad. It's something like 150 kilometers from Islamabad. They expanded there. Incidentally, we realized at that time that they had Stella and Milan missiles, which shows that they had resources coming, of course, from narcotics. And that was the moment when the army had to act. And Kayani then reacted to get control of the Swat Valley again. In this operation, 4.5 million people had to flee, and the number of army people who died was around 200, and the number of the Islamists who were killed, that's official figures, were 1,600. But they could, and 150,000 troops were deployed. So that was an important moment when you saw civil war, in fact, taking shape in that part of the country. But they could regain the place, except that Fazlullah, who was the TTP leader of this area took shelter, found refuge in Afghanistan. That's the irony of the story. The Fatah used to be the safe haven for the Afghan Talibans. Now Afghanistan is the safe haven for the Pakistani Taliban. Of course, because we have less and less NATO troops there, so they can find refuge in Afghanistan and attack Pakistan from Afghanistan. Well, you may ask at that point, and I'm near the end, what is the state doing in this situation? We have now identified three facets of Islamism, and the last one, of course, is the most dramatic one. I mean, the most threatening for the state as an institution. Well, that brings us to the present day situation. And I would have summarized my argument before this, but I think there's no need for any summary. I prefer to get into the last 2 days situation. The politicians, and I mean mostly Imran Khan and Nawaz Sharif, who have won the last elections in May, want to negotiate with the Taliban, and I would say with the Islamists at large. They want to negotiate some settlement. And they consider that their mandate is to restore peace at any cost. I mean, that's what they consider the shortest cut for showing some achievement. This is, by the way, very well in tune with what I have said about Bhutto. Bakali Bhutto had no inhibition to negotiate, to deal with the Islamists. I mean, this kind of dichotomy that we often make between the army people who were in the joint venture with the Islamists and the civilians who are supposedly against the Islamists, this has to be completely revisited. Today, the army people are much more for attacking and crushing the Islamists when the politicians are in favor of some negotiation, some bargaining. In the case of Nawaz Sharif, this is also true vis-à-vis the Sunni activists. He has, and the PMLN, has a soft corner, some, I would say, special equation with the Sunni movements, possibly because of his Saudi connection, and we should not underestimate the depth of this connection. And it's not only Nawaz Sharif, it's his father, it's his brother, it's a very deep relationship. And he has spent so many years in Jeddah developing his own business, and not only that, that we should keep that in mind. So there is not only this sense that negotiations should take place, but also some affinities behind this. Now, whether these negotiations can take him anywhere remains to be seen, but is very doubtful. Why should the Pakistani Taliban negotiate when the NATO forces will be gone for sure in less than 1 year? And then they will have plenty of room for maneuver. That's precisely where the kind of negotiation, that's we can call negotiation, between Karzai and the US is so important. Because if these negotiations fail, and if Afghanistan is left with its army only, it will be very difficult for the Karzai regime to resist. And then the Pakistani Taliban will have their own safe haven in Afghanistan. And the Pakistani state will be under fire even more. So that's a very gloomy picture, but I really don't see how we can portray the situation in a different manner, but I may be wrong, and I would be very happy to be wrong.
So, thank you,
Sorry, can you repeat?
Your opinions or your prognosis on dogmatism in particular, yeah. Warfare in general.
Warfare. But you mean in Pakistan?
Yeah.
You know, and that's the title of my book, Resilience of Pakistan is also absolutely amazing. Who would have expected that that would be the state where you would have achieved justice? We would be able to put a former military chief to the book. Who would have imagined that this country would have had somewhat fair elections with something like an election commission worth that name? There is, you know, if we look for rays of hope, there is this resilience of institutions, you know, and that's quite important, plus a middle class. And it may sound strange because of all these stories, but there is a very well-off middle class, maybe too well-off. The inequalities may be the big problem of the country. These inequalities nurture, foster radicalism. This is a country where nobody pays taxes really, and not only that, because that's not so uncommon. But the inequalities are huge. But still, the middle class is also a stabilizer in some ways. So the worst is never for sure. My fear is that they'll be with this huge problem. The moment there is no NATO forces in Afghanistan, if they have 40,000 militant activists attacking them head-on with some Taliban provinces, maybe not Taliban regime, but Taliban provinces. They may have, you know, there is a fatigue among the army. And you know, it's an army where the generals go to the fire. They have lost officers, many, many officers. It's not an army where you have only the Javans under the fire. There is a fatigue in the army. So even the army in the end can say, yes, let's have a settlement. That may be for 2000, and you know, the US has come out with a report recently saying 2017 is the moment when the Taliban will be back in Kabul. We don't know, but that's quite possible, and that's the main problem.
Center lies in the heart of every human being. They are also human beings.
Of course.
Right. And also the policies, whatever we see. See, the policies actually blend up both. It should be the complicated mechanism as well as the compassion and the non-violence. But the problem is, most of the policies now we see, it is just the self-interest and the coercion.
Yeah. Well, three quick points. First of all, they are in a kind of war situation for decades. And for instance, what happened in Afghanistan in October 2001, where they were there in many of them, now, the killing of so many innocent with bombs coming from the sky, that was a question of humanism, precisely. Eh? And why have the Pashtun people voted for Islamists in 2002. You remember? There was a government of Islamists in Peshawar. For that, as a retaliation to the inhuman treatment that they have suffered. So it's not only their inhumanity. There is also some inhumanity on the other side. Secondly, the use of religion by politicians. I've not mentioned them, but Jamaat-e-Islami, Jamaat Ulema Islam have their own networks. They are, of course, official, legal, but training people who will be there in other movements, which are, of course, of a different kind. And last but not least, the army have used these people, have nurtured these people, have trained them against the Soviets, against India for so many years. Sorry.
How worried should India be, and what are the dialectics of terrorism between India and Pakistan?
Well,
maybe you should collect a few questions.
Okay, I'll keep this one in mind. Yeah.
Please keep the question.
Yeah, yeah.
Just one small addition to the last question, which I think is what I wanted to ask you.
Yeah.
We do not have anything like the Shia-Sunni conflict in India.
No.
I do not know if that can be fomented with Saudi money, and now increasingly, I don't know if the Iranians are also doing the same thing, the Shias. So how can Pakistan infiltrate India? What consequences do we have, which is the last question, too, of what is going on, the horror story in Pakistan?
We take three or four and then...
Yeah, I'll pick up after you finish on this issue.
Okay.
Sir, the point you mentioned about the Shia regrouping, I thought is quite interesting. So I want to know if these three facets have a, you know, is there a scope for them to alter the population demographics of Pakistan? And if they do, do you see any sort of hardcore impact that might have on Pakistan itself?
In what sense, the altering of demography?
Like, right now you said that these three facets are, have their own pockets, right?
Yes.
So if they do alter the demography...
Okay, okay, it's more geographical than,
yeah, yeah,
than demographic, in fact. The geography.
Yes.
Yeah. In the reverse order, because that's clear, that's fresh in our mind. Definitely Pashtun nationalism has declined compared to what it used to be. And it has declined for many different reasons. First of all, the ANP leaders, the Awami National Party leaders, who took over from the National Awami Party, are identified with this old, somewhat aristocratic, and agnostic, secular, progressive, even leftist elites, which is self-contradictory in many ways, because they are the old Maliks and Khans, and at the same time they are progressive in some other sense in terms of secularism. So these people have been under attack, and when they came back, because they were in office till last year, they could not do anything. They were so much under pressure by the Taliban. And you know, during the last election campaign, many of their candidates were killed. So they could not canvass. Neither the ANP nor the PPP could really contest elections last time. So for that reason, by de facto, they cannot promote their ideas. And secondly, I would say Islamism has somewhat prevailed. And even more because now, what is the need for a Pashtun area when you have this kind of porosity between the Pashtun Afghan area and the Pakistani Afghan area, you know, Pakistani Pashtun area? It's what need of Pashtunistan do you have? So for these two reasons, I think it has indeed declined. When it has not declined next door in Balochistan, of course, that's a very active sub-nationalism that will probably suffer more in the future. The geography of this, it's a very good point because, in fact, that allows me to say a word about Punjab. You know, we know about the problems we have in the Pashtun area, in the Balch area, in Karachi, even in Sindh, and we look at Punjab as the stabilizer. But that's the place where you have the sectarian movements. All of them are rooted in Punjab. Mostly South Punjab, Bawalpur, Multan, but even Lahore, even this Jhang. So that would be, if we have to fear something for the stability of the country, if sectarianism grew in that part of the country to such an extent that it would be destabilized, that would be really critical. Interestingly, Nawaz Sharif, being a politician that has some cleverness, he has recently balanced his anti-Shia previous signals
by nominating a Shia as ambassador to the US, which is a remarkably bold, you know, this is the number two post in the world. I mean, and he has also have elected as president of Pakistan someone who has strong connections with Shias. So I think we can imagine that for the stability of the country is downplaying in Punjab, especially this kind of challenge. Can the Shia-Sunni conflict come to India, if I get you right? I don't think so, but I may be completely wrong because I'm not very aware of this terrain. But I would say that, first of all, Shias are really in a small minority. They are not probably as many. Well, there are pockets, of course, in Lucknow. And you have Ismailis, of course, Qajars and Boras, but they are of a different kind in Gujarat and Bombay. And secondly, well, can Muslims afford to divide themselves in India? That would be terribly dangerous. And they may divide themselves along social lines. You may have backward classes Muslims not very happy with the Ashrafs, you know, this divide, Ashrafs versus Ajlaf. And Azals can be there. But at the time of elections and for political reasons, the Shia-Sunni divide, I don't think, could really make any impact. Should India worry? Well, given what has happened, of course, because you can't rule out something like what has happened in the past. The past can repeat itself. Except that I think the army has changed its mind. There is something called the Green Book. The Green Book is a kind of textbook for all officers. For the first time in the last edition, and it's a marginal shift in emphasis, but still, they have considered that the internal threat was as important as the external threat, which is, of course, a play of words, but still. You know, Kayani has, compared to Musharraf, targeted as much as he could, and I insist on that because, of course, he could have done more. But he has really gone a long way to take on these people. Why is he allowing, or why has he allowed drone attacks? Because he wants these guys to be under fire. And I think these drone attacks will continue. Even Rahil Sharif, the new COAS, has not come out with any public statement against the drone attacks. That's an important dimension. With some army officers more interested in taking on the Pakistani Taliban than sending them to Kashmir, well, it's a big difference. The question mark, I mean, there are two question marks. Can the LET be given the kind of room for maneuver that would allow a new Bombay? And what about the Haqqani network? The Haqqani network, so far, has been the fraction of the Pakistani Taliban that the Pakistani army has never fully targeted. What we don't know really is whether the last killing of the son of Jalaluddin Haqqani in Rawalpindi is because of them. They may be even now taking on the Haqqani network. But, you know, this is a huge network. That is something that is not only a network for terrorist attacks. It's an enterprise. It's a state within the state with huge ramifications in Dubai, in Abu Dhabi, everywhere. So these are the two caveats, because these groups can damage India in Afghanistan, but probably also in India.
What is the relationship with terrorist groups in India? How strong is
Well, if I know that, if I knew that, I would tell the CBI. But I would not. I don't know. I don't know. Yes.
I'm Wing Commander Butt, ladies and gentlemen, from Bishop Cotton's XNDA. We go through this kind of military history and war, etc., at a very young age. I'm very pleased with what Christophe has said because there are a lot of additional things that he's given, and I want to interact with him so that there are more inputs from him. But a little bit from what I've seen from this thing is, firstly, the Afghanistan war was first with the British, the first and the second Afghan wars. Now, the most important book to read is The Shadow of the Great Game by N.S. Sarila, which shows that at the time of partition, Churchill wanted a bit to contain the Russian, because at that point in time, it was Britain and Russia. So the mindset, it was not the Americans. It was Churchill who said, I want a piece of Pakistan, of India, before you go. We were united the last time when the Mauryan Empire was there. So this little peace was made. They knew Jinnah was going to die and Nehru was not going to give bases. So this was just up the alley. But the whole thing has gone awry, just like in the Middle East when Churchill interfered there, etc., etc., whatever, Lawrence of Arabia. Okay. Now, after 9/11, everything has come into more sharper focus. What was the background to 9/11? You had the Cold War, right, from the Second World War. You have this kind of brainwashing which has been going on in the wars. And what happened was, if you read Charlie Wilson's wars, it was taking on...
Genesis of world history.
Guard against. And it started with, let's say, you can say with the creation of Bangladesh and with the Simi wars and various other things. I could go on, but I'll do it after the lecture with anybody who's interested.
Thank you.
What is your perspective on the role that the U.S. is likely to play in the Middle East, you know, not just Pakistan, but Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iran, Iraq, you know, this entire...
I just have a question. Is the Islamic credentials of the Taliban, if you look at the Afghan Taliban, I'm differentiating from the Pakistani Taliban, it's more Pakhtunwali which is there. It's not, it's less of Islam. Leave aside lawyer, and the Haqqani network. My question is, sorry, did somebody have something to say? No, my question was just this. Are we generalizing on this issue of Islam in the context of Afghanistan? You have, even there, you have, in the Quram Agency, you have Shias, you have uncircumcised Muslims. The Mesruts themselves are uncircumcised. I think it's, we need to clarify that aspect, whether it's really Islam or it's Pakhtunwali.
So the question I have is that it's often said that a part of the state machinery in Pakistan, which is part of the ISI and part of the army, are actually they actually support these sort of extremist groups. How is that really the case? And does that make it far more complicated to ever find a politically backed resolution?
You said the Shias in small numbers, so there is no possibility of them forming a party or taking recourse to violence. But in Gilgit, Hunza, Chitral, and Skardu, they form about 80%. Yeah. So that combat superiority there is much more. So they could do what they want, but that has not happened, firstly. Secondly, Baluchistan. 30, the Hazara influence in Pashtun area. And fourthly, is there a chance of Pakistan imploding?
China is having in Pakistan. Do you really think there's an Islamic angle to it?
Yeah, I'll take them in the order this time and first look at the role of the US. Well, in the region, no, because I'm not able to go that far. But the role of the US in Pakistan is so important that it is already sufficient. The relationship is at the core of the Pakistani state right from the 50s. And we must keep that in mind. You know, the Eisenhower and Ayub Khan, even before that, Harry Truman, and
and first Dulles coming to meet. We are just after the Korean War, so we have to figure out that for 60 years, with ups and downs, these two countries have had a very strong relationship, and the Pentagon people and the army people in Pakistan have been knowing each other for decades. Now, of course, it's unprecedented in the history of this relationship. They are not on the same side anymore. And the kind of suspicion that Pakistan is creating on the American side, and vice versa, because the anti-Americanism has grown out of proportion in Pakistan. So there is a strong temptation, and I was in Washington less than 2 months ago to deal with this. There is a strong temptation to just pull the plug and stop spending as much money as they are spending. If you look at the figures the Congress is giving, we have now something like $20 billion spent in less than 10 years, two-thirds of it going directly to the army. It's a country where the army probably gets one-fifth of its budget from the US, which is a huge percentage. That's the temptation and there is a fatigue with Pakistan also on the American side. On the other end, and that's the last book by Dan Murky that has just been released, No Exit from Pakistan. You just can't leave the place. You like it or not, you better be there than out, because it is from there that you can somewhat monitor and watch. Now that's why to get the nuclear bomb is so important, because when you go nuclear, you are upgraded to such an extent that you too big to fail, too big to be left on its own. So that will be a very interesting debate next year. This year, of course, they can't do anything because they have to use the Khyber Pass, they have to use Karachi to get away from Afghanistan. 80,000 people have to go, tons of materials have to go. But 2015 will be the time when they'll have to make decisions. And these will be very important for everybody. Islamic credentials of the Taliban. Yes, of course, they are not true to the diversity of Islam. And certainly, the Pakhtunkhwa is the root of their orthodoxy much more than the Islamic, I would say, fundamentalist or version. At the same time, they are imposing a new version of Islam. You mentioned the Shias of the Fatah. They are under attack. And in that sense, that was a point I wanted to make at the end, we have a convergence of the sectarian and the jihadi groups. And many sectarian groups have found refuge in the Fatah, from where they attack people, because now these Pakistani Taliban are Sunni militant. Now, Akimullah Masood, who was the previous TTP chief, was a declared anti-Shia Taliban, for instance. So they are precisely eroding the diversity of Islam. The army support, yes, that's of course the crux of the matter, and it is where we reach what we call the deep state in Pakistan. You know, the deep state being this black box where you do not know what kind of relationship. We have evidence of ISI officers in close, I would say, relationship with Islamists. You know, Colonel Imran was the ISI guy who for 20 years helped the Taliban, and before that the Mujahideen. At the same time, you have people who fought against them and who were killed by them. You know, there is a very interesting story. It's in the last chapter of my book. I came across two characters it would be too long to give the details, but you have a man called Major Haroun. Major Haroun, after 9/11, when he saw what was happening, resigned from the army, joined the LET, and killed the army man, Alavi, whose sister is married to Nabil, and who eventually was the one who attacked the Al-Qaeda people in the Fatah. So it's not that simple. So you have army men on both sides. You can go further. You can say that in one Punjabi family, army family, one guy would go to the LET and one guy will go to the army. And you can find families of that kind. So you can't really say what is true. What is for sure is that Musharraf was much more in favor of this kind of joint venture than the successor. Did I miss one question? No.
China.
Ah, yes, sorry. No, also the Hazara? Yes, sorry, yes. Just one point on the Hazara. No, these people are targeted, not, sorry.
Not only Hazaras, the Dardis and the Baltis in Pak-occupied Kashmir.
Yeah, that was my next, in contrast to the Hazaras, the people of Gilgit-Baltistan are in a majority and are under attack, and they are Shias. In fact, they are Ismailis. The Aga Khan Foundation has done more for them than for anybody, probably. But they are in a very strategic location, so it's full of army men, and Musharraf himself, in 88, probably, was responsible for killing so many Shias. The Hazaras are different. Hazaras are, first of all, people you can recognize easily. And they are doing very well because they know that they have only one asset, education. So they are targeted as a small minority around the Balochistan cities, and it's a different story. Pakistan imploding, you know, we could spend the night on that, but I would have one line response. Karachi is the problem. And they have to fix the problem in Karachi because, you know, Balochistan, they will crush the place. Karachi, it's much more complicated. And it will not implode, but it may not be, quiet either. On China, well, the Islamic dimension is not so much, I would say, a positive factor. It's on the contrary, one of the problems. You know, you have the Uyghurs, as you may know, they have a kind of connection. When you build a road, it's a both-way traffic. So they have built that road. Now people use it from Kashgar to Peshawar. And Uyghurs were there in the Fatah. They have been handed over. Three Uyghurs are leaving Guantanamo very soon. That's an irritant in the China-Pakistan relation. So far, the Chinese have been rather happy with the way the Pakistanis have taken on the Uyghur militants, it seems. But it's, you know, even if there is one small terrorist attack in Umruki or because of them, that can become a problem because that's one of the most, I would say, with Tibet, this is the part of China the Chinese are the most obsessed with. Now, Pakistan can also help China to get access to the Afghan copper. And if they do that, that's bingo because it's really a huge mine that they can exploit and benefit from.
We have 10 more minutes.
Okay. Yes. Yes.
So you asked audience a single question. Can Indian Muslims afford this discrimination? So by this, did you mean that Indian Muslims are facing grave danger in India itself?
It's a question of interpretation. Grim danger can be anything from...
Hindu extremists?
Yes. You know, when you are facing ghettoization, why do you ghettoize? Because you want to be together and be stronger when you are together. Why Jawapura? Why 500,000 people leaving the center of the city and going to the periphery of Ahmedabad? To be stronger. Well, if your priority is to get stronger, why should you divide along any kind of lines? And I mean it, ghettoization is a very special social phenomenon. Rich and poor are going together to a place without any road and any electricity. Rich and poor. You're not there because you're poor. You're there because you're Muslim. So when you have this impulse, when the need for unity is so strong, can you afford to get divided along other lines like these ones? I don't think so. But I may be wrong. I may be wrong. Yeah. Sorry.
Russia and Iran also with this new recent nuclear deal with the U.S. Bringing some kind of stability. What's your view?
That's a good point.
Yeah. I relate that also to the growing distance between the United States and Saudi Arabia.
Yes. Okay.
How vulnerable is the nuclear arsenal in Pakistan?
Very, very.
That is one. And the second one is about economics and hope. Basically, what I see is that some of these terrorist organizations have become centers of excellence in Pakistan. That people look up to join them. Those are well maintained, well managed, great institutions to be there, and there are a lot of jobless youth over there. So is there a way in which the West can plant seeds of economic growth over there, call centers or whatever modern things might be?
Would you be able to draw parallels between extremists in Pakistan, in Islam, and extremists in Hindu India, the Hindu extremists?
Yes, Muli.
Just to add a little diversity, can you tell us a little bit about the labor movement in Karachi?
Yeah.
Okay, so just to add to the question that was raised about economics. So isn't there a way a promise of a better lifestyle could change the entire Islamic movement?
Okay, we'll end with that?
Yes.
Okay. This question of regional players around Afghanistan, including Saudi Arabia, because it's in the region in many ways. No, that's one of the options the Western countries are contemplating to hand over this issue to the neighboring countries. It's clearly a temptation, you know? The same way the US are telling the Europeans, you take care of Libya, you take care of Mali, well, they may try to sell the idea that, well, this is more your problem than our problem. So you better fix it, and you better get together around the table and find a solution for that. I don't think it can work. But there may be attempts for engaging, you know, the way, for instance, the US have asked India to be the intermediary with Karzai. It's a very interesting development, you know. He can't listen to us, please talk to him. We can see that more in the coming year, I mean, this year. But because of the Saudi-Iranian divide, because of the Indo-Pakistan divide, it's very difficult to figure out how a settlement can be achieved by these countries. And the Taliban will wait and watch, and eventually nobody will do anything. Can India do more? Can India do more than training Afghan officers in India? Can India sell arms and train Afghan officers in Afghanistan? I don't see any government doing that. And can Iran do that? So who will train the Afghan army? That's the main point. If the Afghan army remains as it is, it will not resist for long. But who will train them? The Europeans are about to tell Karzai, we do not have enough money to train a 350,000 large army. You have to downsize it to 80,000 and make it professional, because we can't pay. That's what will be said in the next meeting. Can the neighbors pay and train the Afghan army? It will be a very interesting, I would say, and disturbing debate in the coming month, I'm sure. Well, how vulnerable the nuclear assets are, nobody knows. I mean, I don't know. For sure, the Americans have tried hard to provide, to offer any kind of security guarantee to have access to these things. Apparently, they were not successful, and we can only measure the number of warheads, which is increasing. Now, where are they? Are they disseminated? Are they concentrated? Very difficult to say. Center of excellence, that's a bit too much, because these Islamist groups are not so much center of excellence. They are more, they are offering a kind of dignity. They are offering a kind of social ability. Now, we can speak about astrophization, the same way we speak about Sanskritization. You are a Kasab, and you go to Muridke, and you're fed, you're given dress, you are somewhat respected. And in his case, it did not go very far. But it's more in terms of social work again that I would, and of course, in terms of discipline, again, character building is the word. FDI, my God, nobody wants to invest in Pakistan. No, call centers, yes, of course, but the Chinese are the only ones, and the Saudis. They invest massively, but it's a huge problem. And in fact, I would precisely go on with this issue of the threat of living. That's a key question. Electricity is a huge problem. Instead of turning to India to get power, Pakistan is now buying the Central Asian power electricity, which is a waste of money, and they are not in a position to build the pipeline between Iran and Pakistan. So when you're in Lahore, I've never been trapped the way I've been trapped in Lahore in 30 years of South Asia. Because it's so congested, there's no power, and it is Lahore. You can imagine smaller places. It's really in a bad shape. So, of course, this is fostering the sense of revolt, sense of, I would say, resentment vis-à-vis the establishment and vis-à-vis very super rich people. And when the prime minister is the richest man in the country, speaking volume, and people know that. Nawaz Sharif has taken over from Zardari in that sense.
How much percentage of the population is employed in these activities?
No, these figures do not make any sense, because unemployment, the figures are, of course, there are a massive underemployment or an unemployment problem. The last three questions. How can we compare extremism in India and Pakistan? There are
there are many similarities in the sense that character building, for instance, a long-term agenda. You do not enter politics, but you work at the grassroots level and you wait for the state to fall as a ripe fruit. These are things we have heard of here. And character building, I insist, with a kind of elite ethos that has a lot of attraction. Plus social work, grassroots, crisscrossing of the country. The difference, the big difference is that in Pakistan, because it's an Islamic republic, you cannot resist those who want more Islam because this is the legitimate agenda. So the secular people, and there were many secular leaders. You know, if you look at the speeches Jinnah made, Liaquat Ali Khan made in the 40s, 50s, you close your eyes, you listen to Nehru. It is the same speech. But they could not resist Jamaat Islami, they could not resist the ulemas, because Islam was the legitimate identity. So in the end, they ended up with a kind of compromise. The 56 constitution says minorities will be protected, Article 18, but the prime minister will be a Muslim and cannot be anything but a Muslim. You have to keep this. But when those who say, because this is an Islamic country, we want the Ahmadis, who are not Muslims, to be excluded, Bhutto bowed to them. He couldn't, and that was the beginning of the end. That was really the beginning of the end for secularism in Pakistan. So that's a big difference. In India, you can at least say there is the word secular in the constitution. If you want to change the constitution, come on and say what you want. It's a big difference because you can always fall back on that, and there is a judiciary that is supposed to take care of that. The labor movement, I'm afraid, Molly, has been completely destroyed by the very same man who won power because of it. Bhutto was the most cynical man in that sense that you can imagine. There is a very good book called by Lal Khan. You know this book, yeah? It's a fabulous book because it shows from the inside how he used the trade unions and how he crushed them. And of course, Zia finished the job. And there is the Communist Party of Pakistan was outlawed in 54. Bhutto disposed of the trade unions in Karachi, especially. What's left? I would say, in that sense, there are two poles of resilience. The media who are really courageous. The number of journalists who die in Pakistan every year, and sometimes in a very dramatic manner, is showing how courageous some of them are. So the media is there. The GOTV did such a good job during the Musharraf year that he was probably... in a bad situation because of them. The NGOs, the Human Rights Commission, is not, like in India, a public institution, it's an NGO. It's a very good place as well. And in fact, on Monday, we'll meet with Asma Jahangir in Colombo for precisely looking at secularism in these different countries, and she's one of those. And she's a lawyer, and I must add this, of course, the judiciary. Even though the judiciary is... not that progressive. You know, the way they wanted to get rid of Musharraf had much to do with anti-Americanism, much more than progressive views. But still, you have bar associations, you have people who stood and put Zardari, Gilani, and now Musharraf in the courtroom. I mean, Dadari, not yet, but it may happen. And Musharraf, we don't know, because he may just leave the country before. Last point on the Pakistani youth. That's a very good question. Islam among the youth.
there is a resurgence. There is a resurgence of religiosity. And religiosity becomes a kind of identity. You know, you may become religious because you're anti-American, but still, that's how you find your dignity. I don't know if some of you have read that book, The Reluctant Fundamentalist. And it will become a film. Maybe it has been. It is already, yes. Well, this story is rather, I would say, convincing. I mean, you can figure out that, yes, it works like that. So you're not necessarily religious because of the belief, but also because of the identity quest for some alternative and some dignity again. Especially when you are not with any job, with any resource.